Let's have a look at who's in my green room tonight. We have a true Hollywood great with us tonight, ladies and gentlemen. His record of being the world's number one box office star for 5 straight years is still unmatched to this day. He was the star of such unforgettable movies as Mean Machine, Smokey and the Bandit, Cannibal One, Deliverance and so many more. It is, of course, the one and only Mr. Burt Reynolds. The great Burt Reynolds, right there. Burt, it's fantastic to have you here. I'm excited. Now, I've watched my next guest grow from being a pale, frail, waif-like youth obsessed with sci-fi and cult movies into a pale, frail, waif-like man obsessed with sci-fi and cult movies. From space to Shaun of the Dead, from Hot Fuzz to Star Trek, one of my favourite actors and writers, it's Simon Pegg. There he is. Professor Pegg is in the house. He gets better with the years. Now, one of the things I love about having the opportunity to make a show like this is that we can introduce you sometimes to rising stars, someone who you might not know that well yet, but who I think is destined for great things, someone like my next guest. She's an actor, she's a singer, a poet, and the writer and star of a great new sitcom called Chewing Gum. I think you're going to love her. It's Michaela Cole. There she is. Hey, Michaela. She's coming up. And speaking of new talent, we have a rising band, not so well known at the moment, but I think they may well go all the way. They might be a bit nervous, because this is a big crowd for them, so I wanted you to give them a big, warm welcome, make them feel at home. I think I've got this right. They're called The Coldplays. The Coldplays. You've heard of them, okay. They'll be chatting and playing for us later in the show. Now, before we get to that, a fascinating survey I saw this week revealed the habits and lifestyles of the typical British 30-something man, okay? Now, Bert, this doesn't apply to you because, of course, you're American, right? Simon, I know you're 45, but I think this applies to you because, of course, you are incredibly immature, right? But Coldplay, you boys are bang on for the demographic of this survey. So I want to use you as our focus group here. We've given you paddles, I believe, so you can respond. So, Mr. British 30-something, according to this survey, typically drives a hatchback car. Fellas? The typical British 30-something is optimistic about his prospects in the future. Huh? Well, wait till we've heard the new album, we'll let you know. Now, favourite films of the typical 30-something man in this country are Dirty Dancing, Home Alone, and Shaun of the Dead. Fellas? Actually, Shaun of the Dead wasn't on the list, but I didn't want to hurt his feelings.
He's in it.
We're in it.
The average 30-something has 3 favourite bands, according to the survey. In this country, they are Queen, The Beatles, and Coldplay. Any guesses who the third one might be? It's Take That! It's Take That! Okay, let's get my first guest out. He is, as I said earlier, one of the biggest stars Hollywood has ever produced. His movies were box office gold. They were great fun. They were always packed with action. Here is a little flavour of those times.
Mr. Sinatra,
you may call me Frank.
I got Frank.
Not yet. I'll let you know when you can.
Bandit!
As you probably know, we're the favorites to win the cannonball tomorrow, and I was wondering if one of you or both of you might like to ride in the winning vehicle.
Oh, that would be very exciting.
Exciting.
But we're cannonballers ourselves, thank you.
They're cannonballers?
And, as for the winning vehicle, well, we'll just have to wait and see. You haven't seen our equipment.
Too late now.
Ladies and gentlemen, it's Burt Reynolds. So great to have you on the show. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Wow. Burt Reynolds. That's lovely. Bert is over. Bert's in the UK because he has a book out. He has bought his book out, the book out, I guess. Bert Reynolds, But Enough About Me. It's out now, and it's a full-blooded, it's a fascinating read, but it's a full-blooded, very truthful, it strikes me as, account of your life.
Yes. It's quite complimentary.
Why write it now? What was the spur for doing it now? Why did you decide this is the time?
Well, I'm getting old. And I thought it was, you know, time to write the truth. And, you know, there's been so many lies about my life. And my own fault, really. And so I thought I'd write the truth. And along the way, I'd thank some people that were wonderful to me. And go after a few assholes.
That's probably the most enticing description of a book I've ever heard. If I was going to buy a book, that's the one I'd go for. Because you don't mince your words in here. You talk about people, honestly, and there are some people who stood by you through the years when things weren't going as well.
Right.
And others who didn't. And, of course, it's a cliché to say that you find out when your true friends are in those sort of circumstances, but, of course, it's a cliché for good reason. It's the truth. And you really did find out, I guess, who was really there for you
and
who was not.
They left in droves.
What was the downturn in your life that caused people to distance themselves from you or for not want to publicly associate themselves with you?
Well, I went from number one to number 85, I think, in 1 year.
Wow.
85 is a nice number, but it wasn't good, you know?
Let me ask you about some of the things that happened during that period that must have been alarming and awkward to live to. A rumour went through Hollywood that you had contracted AIDS, that you were HIV positive.
Well, I was very thin. I had lost a lot of weight because of the circumstances. I just couldn't eat. And I had a fight scene in the very first scene in a picture I did with Clint Eastwood. And the guy picked up the wrong chair. He didn't pick up the breakaway. He picked up a real chair, and he caught me across the jaw, and he broke my jaw about four places. And so I couldn't eat. I just could, you know, have milkshakes and things. And so I went down to 135 pounds, and people wondered, what happened to him? And it was... I couldn't eat. So... It was an interesting time. That's when you find out who your friends are.
So you were incredibly underweight, and you were, I guess, using painkillers to deal with the pain of that as well.
Yeah, well, I took painkillers because I liked them. And it took away the pain, which was important at that time.
Yeah.
I mean, Hollywood is... Everybody loves you at a certain time, and then everybody leaves at a certain time. What helped, really, was Johnny Carson. I went on that show, and we made jokes about how skinny I was and about my beautiful body, which is gone.
That looks like Tom Selleck there.
Yeah, I told him, I wrote him a note one time, and I said, you've got a wonderful style, mine.
Interesting, because your body, in a way, you had not been objectified, but certainly you, the posing for the centerfold in Cosmopolitan, which was a remarkable thing to do, a movie star like you at the very top of his game, and I think you met... Did you not meet the publisher or the editor on the Johnny Carson show? And she suggested that to you?
Helen Gurley Brown, who was just relentless. I laughed at her. I said, I'm not going to do that. And so she kept asking me. Six times she asked me. And the seventh time I said, oh, what the hell, okay. Now, what am I going to do? And she said, you just pose nude and you can do it any way you want. And I said, well, can it be on a warm day? And a matter of fact, it wasn't. It was very cold. And there I was, you know, with nothing on, and trying to look virile. And, you know, you're standing there with no clothes on, you feel real silly. And I thought, if my dad sees this, he's going to beat the shit out of me. He did.
Yeah. We have the photograph.
You do.
One thing that strikes me as being amazing, you know, and you were an incredible fine figure of a man, because if you saw a movie star today doing this, you wouldn't see this, is just the sheer amount of body hair.
I never got any credit for that. And I don't know as it's anything you have to be proud of. I mean, you just look like a half of an ape. You know?
This is the classic, and this, in some ways, it haunted Bert, I guess, and still does today. But this is Bert in Cosmopolitan, and you'll see what I mean by the 70s manscaping going on now. So you see what I mean there? And you look like you're having a great time. I know you're an actor and you're in the moment there, but was it a fun thing to shoot?
I was smashed. Absolutely smashed.
You look relaxed. You look relaxed.
I was very relaxed. I was any more relaxed, I couldn't have gotten up.
Yeah. Even the... That's a nice one. I appreciate that. Okay. A lovely flourish there. Let me ask you about... We're going to change the subject here now, because you mentioned him already. Your father.
Yes.
He looms large in the book. What a very, very strong character, a dominant character...
Yes,
..he is in the book and in your life. Right in the book, did you learn more about the way you felt about him? Did you change the way you felt about him? Did you come to terms with things that he'd said or done to you in the past in a way that you hadn't previously?
No. We didn't ever... He couldn't say, I love you. He was from that generation, you know, that didn't hug and kiss and say, I love you. But he did say, finally, I'm proud of you. And that was enough. That was enough for me. Right now, it makes me cloud up when I think of it, when he said it to me.
It is. It's wonderful then that you got to hear that. You got that from him. Even if you never got, I love you, you knew that in the way he could communicate it.
That was, I love you.
Yeah.
In his way. Yes, it was.
And he was a kind of, I guess he was your hero when you were a kid, I guess.
Oh my gosh, he was. He was the chief of police. He arrested me. Put me in jail, and I...
Hold it, what did he arrest you for? We need to know.
I was fighting. Okay. Probably because somebody said I was sweet-looking in the magazine. Anyway, I got in a fight, and the fight kept building, and it was a big, much bigger fight than I anticipated. And anyway, he came in, and he grabbed everybody and threw us in jail. And he came in, and he said, your father's here, you can go home. Your father's here, you can go home. And he came to me, and he said, your father didn't show up. So I stayed in there for 2 days with every drunk he arrested thrown on top of me.
Wow.
And it was tough. It was a tough 3 days. Did I learn anything from it? Yeah, I learned that he wasn't ever going to say, I love you, go home. He just said, finally, get out. I need this. I need the room. My son, who I hug and kiss and grab and love and say, I love you, I love you, I love you. When he sees me coming, he goes... But I can't help it. I don't want him to have what I had. I want him to have... to know his father loves him so much.
Well, that's the loveliest thing you could give him.
Yes.
The book is incredible, ladies and gentlemen. It's full of great stories. There's so much about the true emotional side of Bert's life. There's so much about his career. And there's so many incredible people that he met along the way, including in the book. You talk about playing poker with both Elvis Presley and Frank Sinatra.
Yes.
Wow. Now, first of all, how did that come about? And secondly, more importantly, who won?
I won for a while, and then Mr. S looked at me. gave me that look, you know, which means don't win anymore. And I didn't. Elvis was wonderful. He was sweet, young, and yes, sir. And I said, Elvis, we're the same age. You don't have to call me sir. And he said, yes, I do, sir. I respect you. I always have respected you, and I always will, sir. Wow. I said, okay, then. What the hell am I going to do about that? And you seem to just have this magic spell of women all over you. And he said, you're not doing bad, sir.
But it's great to have you here. You're going to stay with us for the rest of the show, I hope.
I'll stay as long as the people want me to.
Okay, well, I think that's going to be a while. Ladies and gentlemen, we'll be joined with me by Simon Pegg, Michaela Cole, and Coldplay still to come on the show. Don't go away. Mr. Burt Reynolds. The fabulous Mr. Burt Reynolds is still with us, I'm delighted to say. But let's now get my next guest out. He's the star of Shaun of the Dead, Mission Impossible, and, of course, the Star Trek movies. Not only that, he plays the harmonica. Yes, you heard it here. He plays the harmonica. It's Mr. Simon Pegg. Simon, you can sit over here. Yeah. We bump you along as the show goes on.
Wow.
We do that.
I never thought I'd be doing that for Burt Reynolds.
Well, Burt, of course, now you guys have never worked together, of course. Have you met Burt before?
I met Burt once at a sort of collector mania thing back in about 10 years ago. We met very briefly. The man, it was like a signing event where you sign autographs, and Burt's guy came over and said, oh, Burt would really like to meet you. And so we went over thinking, this is amazing. Burt Reynolds wants to... It was him. He wanted to meet us, and he used Burt. He used you to get to us.
Wow.
I was gutted. But I still got to meet you, which was nice.
Did Burt... Because, interestingly, that isn't in the book, that story. It's not...
When I met Simon Pegg, it was...
But, you know, the cool thing is, I was thinking, you know, you've just come off... you're making the Mission Impossible films now with Tom Cruise. That's a big part of your career. Rogue Nation was the last one. That's out on DVD. Great fun, of course. And in that, I noticed that Tom, of course, being Tom, does a lot of his own stunts.
Yeah.
And, of course, Burt kind of started that in the day. You were one of the only leading men who used to do all his own stunt work.
Which is why I can't walk very well.
Yeah, I think Tom's very much in the tradition of you, Burt, in terms of actually wanting to be the person doing the stunt, because it means more when it's the actor. You can cut to a stunt professional.
It saves a lot of time.
But also the audience think, wow, that's Burt Reynolds doing that, or that's, you know, or it's Tom Cruise, whatever. It makes a difference to the experience of watching the movie. And I think, you know, you probably set a standard there for, you know, believability in action cinema.
Do you ever regret doing that, though? I know you had fun. I know you formed great friendships with the stuntmen and women you work with, but do you ever think, OK, I shouldn't have done all that, or is that a cause of regret?
Certain times in the morning, I'm trying to get out of bed, I remember... that was a long shot. And then I can point to certain places and... That's a certain picture, and it's very embarrassing if you're with a woman and you go to throw her over to the other side of the bed, and your knee goes out. Yeah.
He's still doing it.
He's still doing it.
Still doing
his own stuff.
All his own stuff, ladies and gentlemen. Wow. You know, for the edit, we might replace that with a stuntman, just for that. So, Simon, when you're making Mission Impossible, the sequence at the top of the movie, you're hiding out in the grass.
It completely describes my relationship with Tom Cruise. I'm covered in a grass suit, with dirt all over my face, being Mr. Comedy, and he's hanging onto the side of a plane, literally hanging onto the side of a plane.
But we could look at the other way and saying you have chosen to be in a comfortable reclining position for the day, you know, just chilling.
Yeah.
He's hanging from a plane.
Yes. And we didn't... See, when we watch him do it, he might die. Yeah. When you watch him do it, you know he's all right, because you've seen him, you know, he's doing his...
But you're there on the floor watching
him. I'm watching him, and there were so many variables on that day, because there was the wind speed, there were birds in the air, there was particulate on the runway, there's temperature...
Hold on. There was what on the runway?
Particulate.
Wow, that's a technical term you've acquired.
I didn't even know I was going to say
Who's ever said there's particulate
I surprised myself when that came out.
Well, did anyone say that to you?
I think there was, like, an RAF guy who said particulate.
Wow, you ever heard that? You ever had a discussion about particulate before?
Yeah, about particulate. Everyone, we all know about particulate, right? I mean, geez, it's very common.
Well, with the snowy weather coming, if you live next to an old person, go outside and clear the particulate off their face. The particulate aside, so you're thinking that, and you know Tom's going to be doing this, and there is a chance, of course, this could be Sayonara Tom Cruise.
Yeah, everybody was very nervous that day, including him, and you don't usually see him get nervous. He's focused, so he looked like he was bricking it.
Okay, so let's have a look. This is how... We'll show you, first of all, this is how it appeared in the movie. This is Mission Impossible Rogue Nation, and this is how you saw that scene in the film, and it's a great... You know, it couldn't be a better opening to a film. Have a look at this.
Can you open the door? I'm by the plane. Benji, can you open the door?
Maybe.
Open the door when I tell you! I'm on the plane! Open the door!
How did you get in the plane?
Not in the plane! I'm on the plane! Open the door!
So far, I mean, that's pretty good. You know, he's on the side of a plane. What happens, though, is while he's there, they actually do take off.
Mm-hmm.
That's what's incredible.
Yeah.
So we're going to show this sequence here. So this is the behind-the-scenes footage, and you were there when they were making all this.
I was on the plane, yeah.
And you knew. You climbed on the plane now.
I was... Just because we'd shoot my scenes, and then while they set up the stunt... So then when I wasn't doing my scene, they said, oh, well, come on the plane. So I sat in the cockpit and had a ride and stuff.
Wow.
It's great. Meanwhile, Tom Cruise is on... I don't know if you've ever been on a plane when Tom Cruise is on the outside, but it's a lot of fun. It really is.
I'm glad you're on the plane, though, because they need someone to look out for the particulate. So you could have been...
I was on particulate watch.
You were his wingman right there. You were ice. OK, here we go. Now, look at this. This is the behind-the-scenes footage from Rogue Nation. Look at this.
I'm feeling the force of the wind hit me. I'm actually scared of this.
Wow. Yeah. I worry about what he's going to do now.
Well, you mean in terms of how you're going to top it, or...?
Well, because we're going to make Mission Impossible 6.
That's been announced, has it?
Chris Mission McQuarrie Impossible. Is... I don't know if I'm in it yet,
you're
but...
Of course,
you know,
you're in it.
Fingers crossed. But it literally... What are you going to do, jump off the moon?
Wow.
I'm worried about him. I think he could seriously hurt himself if he's not careful.
There's so much to talk to you about at the moment. I'm so excited about two things coming up. Of course, there's the Star Trek film.
Yes.
Star Trek Beyond. And the exciting thing about this, I think, is you're not just in it, of course. You've co-written this one.
I did. I co-wrote it with Doug Jung.
Who wow.
Was, yeah. That
wow.
was kind of extraordinary.
Yeah, please tell us something about it.
It's set in space.
Well, that is something. Because sometimes Star Trek, they remember when he went back in time, they were stuck on Earth. It was Gangster Pier, Joan Collins,
great.
Boom,
yeah,
boom, boom.
City on the Edge of Forever.
Thank you.
This one, it's they're out on the 5-year mission. You know,
wow.
It's they're out in the depths of space.
And Idris Elba is the villain.
Lovely Idris Elba, yes.
But you're not answering that question.
I'm just saying, lovely Idris Elba.
Yeah. I can't wait for it. Do you have any favourites? I mean, if you had to choose, Star Wars, Star Trek, you have a foot in both camps, somewhat.
I am by Star Real. Mate, that's better than particulate.
You were asked to be in Star Wars, weren't you, Bert?
No.
I thought you were... I thought you were...
I love it when you just are sitting there with... What?
I read you were approached to be...
Yes, I was.
Well, you were.
Yeah.
You've got to stop doing that to me. I'm not a young man anymore. You're going to finish me off, so to speak.
I should have done it, actually.
Well, obviously.
Especially but... in the band, it was the second biggest film that year, wasn't it? So you
yes,
would have been
in
the two biggest films.
It was the second biggest.
Wow. OK, ladies and gentlemen, Mission Impossible 5 Rogue Nation is out on Monday on DVD. It's great fun. Can't wait for number 6. So you'll film that next year, hopefully.
I think so, yeah.
Get a move on. There you go. Mr. Simon Pegg, ladies and gentlemen. Still to come on the show, we'll be joined by Michaela Cole and Coldplay. So see you after the break. Let's get my next guest out here right now. She is the breakthrough comedy star of the year. I've been loving her very funny new sitcom, Chewing Gum. Please make her feel very welcome. It's Michaela Cole.
Nice to see you too.
Michaela, come and sit down. Well, it's great to have you here. I'm very excited you're on the show. For people who might not have seen Chewing Gum yet, because it's been on E4.
Yes.
How do you describe the character you play in it and the story, the life that she lives?
Well, it's about a girl called Tracy, who's 24, and she's been raised in quite an extreme Pentecostal evangelical family. And at 24, she kind of decides, I want to have sex now. I want to, have friends that aren't just in my church. And it's kind of about her basically going through adolescence at 24.
A little bit later. And I believe they've commissioned a new series for
you.
Yes,
they have.
Well, that's congratulations.
Thank you.
Let me show you a little clip. It's a very funny show and she's very lovely in it. This is Michaela in Chewing Gum.
You hearing me? Listen, mate. You're definitely missing my party to break your hymen.
It's just dinner with Ronald. You have a party every week.
I ain't even upset. I'm proud. It's time!
Candice, I'm 24. I'm a virgin. Yes, that doesn't mean I have to want to have sex with my boyfriend, yeah?
You don't have to. You can bang someone on Tinder. It's free. Set the team to find someone in your borough and walk. A Tinder bang ain't even a bus fare, bro.
Candice is, like, the roughest girl I've ever seen on the whole of my estate, but she's got learning difficulties, so it sort of balances it out. So, like, I can be best friends with her, and I ain't jealous or anything.
You know if you leave it too long, you'll tear when he enters you. You'll need stitches.
Yeah, well, thank God for the NHS then, innit?
That's Chewing Gum on E4. You can obviously find it somewhere on Catch Up. There's all places these days. You're talking there about relationships, a big part of the show, of course. Your relationships, or lack of,
yes.
And the other characters. Real life, the same kind of situation for you?
Well, yeah, I guess being... I was quite, like, a really militant Christian and I didn't do any of the relationship stuff when I was supposed to.
So is that where you... Were you born into that family or did you find you... So you weren't born into a strict religious family?
No, I had a really normal family, actually. They were really just normal down the line. And then I became a Christian at 18, but I didn't do it, like, the healthy way. I kind of went about it in, like a Christian, like, really militant soldier.
Yeah.
I was really extreme.
So obsessive, almost.
Like, obsessive, yeah. Lost all my mates. I was, like, a crazy person.
So what would you say to your friends who hadn't joined you on the on the bus, so
I remember being in uni and I was, like, sitting in my mate's house and I went into her room and she had, like, a cream for tattoos, which meant she must have got a tattoo.
Yeah.
And I actually started crying in her house.
Wow.
And I was like, God is not going to love you if you've got a tattoo. Now I have a tattoo. So, clearly changed my mind.
Yeah. The thing that was also mentioned in that clip then, of course, was Tinder. Your character is talking about that with a friend there.
Yes.
Is this something you've encountered in real life?
Well, actually, I did download Tinder in Bulgaria. I'm doing a show out there, so I've been there for 3 months and was like, I can do it there, because no one knows my face and it's going to be quite...
So, great opportunity.
Great opportunity. Meet
Bulgarian gentlemen.
Going to Tinderize myself
Tinderized.
And see what that's like. Yeah. But the Bulgarian guys on Tinder. But I think steroids are a big deal there. They're very into, like, this. Even if they're, like, 4 foot, they're going to be, like, and it's like there's muscles here. And then they have, like, in the Tinder profile pitch, they have little, like, kittens. So they're, like, these massive guys that just kind of, like, hold. It's quite weird.
So now, do you censor yourself for the show? Because obviously, it's not just friends and family and viewers can see it, but it's going to be, you know, closer family members who maybe aren't au fait with the world of Tinder and the modern world. So, like your parents or grandparents, do you ever, are you worried that they might think that is you all the way through?
Well, no. My mum, who's here, actually, she can't.
Are your mum's here? Where's your mum?
She has to stand, didn't it? Literally thinks she's like a superstar now.
So hold it. So say it again. So your mum thinks she's a superstar.
Yes,
now.
I had a show on E4. My mum thinks she's Kim Kardashian. It's incredible. My mum is like, I'm forwarding you all the look at my workmates. They think you're amazing. Therefore, I'm amazing. She's loving life. But yeah. I think actually, I had to kind of censor chewing gum. People think it's really extreme.
Yeah.
But the actual awkwardness of my sexual history. Is worse, you wouldn't believe it.
Well,
so
tell us one story now. Let's test this out. A mum, and you don't have
mum,
to listen
please,
right now.
Please, please. Yeah, it's just. Okay. So here's one. I was seeing this guy very, very briefly, and, you know, I didn't know much about, like, how, like, the guys out of church were. I didn't know, so I was just like, okay, guys go to sex clubs. Cool, that's what they do. I'll just go with them to the sex club.
Wow.
So
he was taking you to sex club and you thought this was just what everyone did?
Yeah. Well, and also, there was a lot of people there. So I was like, cool, this is
what
they do. Well,
I imagine they're very popular clubs.
Yeah. But they were very... And, you know, everybody was in there, like, bikinis. There was, like, a jacuzzi and, you know, steam room and, like, a bar. And they're playing R&B.
Where is this?
Yeah.
But where is it?
It's actually... It's a club you sign
online. The street and the name of the house.
But they move around. They move around, you see. So the... People like you.
Okay. So people like me don't go.
You'd be good there.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, anyway. Anyway. So yes, we're in this. No, mum. So we're in this club, and there's this couple, and they're kind of giving like me and like the guy I was seeing the kind of like, ooh, we like you kind of like look. And as someone who isn't bisexual, I suddenly went, oh, this could be quite interesting because I'm not. Bisexual, and the man's wife took a liking to me. So he came and he said, you know, my lady likes you. And I was like, oh, wicked, that's really nice, like, cheers. And so, you know, he brought her over, sort of, like, introduced them, and, you know, it's all kind of unsaid, but they kind of did, like, an ushering for us to kiss. And I'm down for anything. I'll give it a try once. So I'm sort of making my way, like, through her anatomy. This is true.
Whoa,
and I'm apologising. Yeah, and I'm like, mum,
get out.
It's not my thing, mum.
Just the one-off.
Yes, and I was just apologising. I'm going, I'm so sorry, I don't know what I'm doing. I don't do this. It's not my vibe. I'm so sorry. And she was just sort of giggling, looking at me really
so
weird.
So were you feeling awkward because you were uncomfortable in the situation, or did you feel that you were misleading?
No, I just think generally, if you're not bisexual, you just shouldn't have a threesome with your fella and a girl.
I think that's probably, yeah.
You sound like my wife.
Yeah.
Sorry.
My wife's actually here.
What about the poetry side of your life? Because here's a question that normally we might well shy away from, because poetry, you think that's one of those things that people often think, ooh, here we go. But you're a modern, you're a poet, you're a performance poet as well. You do poetry slams, is that right?
Yeah, I used to pay my bread and butter. I used to, like, compete, and you, whoever, like, the audience, like, will win, like, 50 quid.
So what kind of poetry would you do? Would this be, once again, personal stuff in your life?
Yeah, personal stuff. You know, sometimes I try and keep it light-hearted so you don't get all indulgy and a bit wanky, so I try to keep it a bit light.
Would you give us a piece of poetry? Would that be OK for me to ask you to do that, or would that be a weird thing?
OK, yeah, I'm going to try and make it short, though. OK. All right, I'll give it a go. I want the kind of love that adores me for things I never knew I had, that picks apart my every flaw and kisses every one of them like medicine. The kind of love that would never leave me, even if my schoolgirl acne resuscitated from the dead on my face and attacked me, if Ben and Jerry's held me beyond my power and forced me to devour their flavour of strawberry cheesecake. And I put on a bit of weight. Love would never leave me, and I'd always be love's favourite taste. If my skin and teeth were a couple shades darker, love wouldn't hold a paper bag to my face for a marker and say you don't fit the quota, forget it. Because unlike us, love ain't that pathetic. I want the kind of love that's eclectic and addictive, the kind of love I never want to miss another minute with. And love would never leave me fumbling in the dark for my keys. His house has many mansions and there's one open for me. She says, come in. Leave your bags of heartache and disappointment at the door. Have a seat here and taste something sweeter than honey. How I crave this kind of love. I think I need this kind of love. How we all already have a love like this.
Wow. Beautiful. That was lovely. That was lovely, wasn't it? Okay. That's good. Okay. So now
for this inaugural Poetry Slam evening, Simon Pegg will now do his.
There was a young lady from Ealing.
Okay. That would be about the level, wouldn't it?
I started doing poetry when I...
So you wrote poetry?
Yeah, when I was a stand-up comedian, how I got into stand-up was doing performance poetry, and then the links between the poems got longer and I phased the poems out.
Didn't you write a poem about Sigourney Weaver?
I did.
I read that, but then you worked with her years later.
I did, and I told her, and I seem to remember, as I began to tell her... The poem, Sigourney Weaver is the loveliest person. And I ran up and said, listen, I was in love with you when I was a student. I wrote this great poem. And I started to tell it, and I realised that I'd rhymed Sigourney with horny. but I'd already begun the poem. So that ended badly.
Michaela, I'm so thrilled you came on the show. It's been
pleasure.
Lovely having you here. You've been both charming, entertaining, and showed off an incredible talent there, which I don't think anyone ever done on this show before. So, Mum, who's here this evening, congratulations. You'll be very proud. Not that you needed me to validate in any way. Thank you so much for coming in. I'm looking forward to Series 2 of Tune. I'm Michaela Cole, ladies and gentlemen. Simon and Michaela, stay with us. Still come to the show. Chris Martin and Coldplay performing live in the studio. Don't go away. Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. Simon Pegg and Michaela Cole are still here, and we've got live music from Coldplay coming up. But before that, let's have a quick chat with their frontman. Please welcome Chris Martin. You know, Simon, of course, it's Michaela.
You did so great.
Come sit down, dude. Great to have you here. Thank you for coming back on the show. Chris is here because I'm excited to say Coldplay have a new album out, ladies and gentlemen. Head Full of Dreams. This is out now. This is already out right now, yeah?
Yeah.
Wow, Head Full of Dreams. Beautiful artwork as well. I love that.
Thanks.
Congratulations. I've listened to it. It strikes me it's very upbeat. It seems to be... I don't know if you guys are in a happier place or whether you've decided to make it, but it feels like it is in... I mean, it's less miserable than some deliberate, I hope.
Yeah, I think it's kind of where we've always been hoping we'd get to.
So all those albums you've been working.
It's like Simon knows because he's been around since the first ones. But yeah, that's kind of where we've always been trying to get to.
We've known each other since when we were cool.
We grew up on a farm, didn't we?
Yeah, we grew up on a farm together. It's strange for me watching the way that they've always been very funny, happy guys. You know what I mean? They're sort of at this reputation came about they're all miserablists and. But I think the songs are just very heartfelt and very sort of emotional, and that was read as being. But they've always been daft. He's always been daft.
Yeah,
Chris.
Yeah.
That started like a compliment.
He's an idiot. He's an absolute idiot. Really.
I think that's what this album's about. It's about coming to terms with people thinking you're a knob and being like, okay, don't worry about it.
How did you two...
What I mean is they've always been happy.
I'm sorry. Yeah.
I can see the brothership.
Okay. This is the new Tinder threesome we're looking at right here.
Okay, I'll give it a go, Chris. Fancy it?
The answer is still no.
Yeah. 15 years. 15 years I've been alive.
By the way, By the way. So when Jonathan asked you that question, I was like, well, I grew up really religious too and I had a similar experience. And when he said, tell some story, I was like, she's going to tell a nice story about first time at the disco and kissing a guy. I was like, then we went to a sex club.
In the deep end.
Oh, yeah. This won't go in the show, but we did a video a couple of years ago in this old mansion. And our dressing room smelled very strange and there was a pile of mattresses in the corner. And Will, our drummer, or someone said to the person showing us around, what's with the mattresses? And he said, oh, there was an orgy here last night. And he said, don't go in the jacuzzi. It's like cum soup in there.
Oh!
Anyway, where were we? The question was, how did we meet? Was that the question?
Well, was there a question? I can't remember now. Oh, yeah, when did you guys meet? Because you've been friends for a long while.
We met... First of all, Simon just got a show on Channel 4 when we first met, and he was opening for Steve Coogan live. When Steve would go off to do his costume changes, this other guy would come on and be really very funny.
And steal the show. I mean, that was the way it was.
And he had a character who had owl eyes, and I just thought that was brilliant. And I was like...
I've come a long way since then.
And now you're godparents to each other's kids, aren't you? Is that correct?
Yeah.
Could be.
Are you good? Are you a good godfather? I'm a godfather one child. I'm trying to be good.
Chris bought round his Brit Award.
Can I say this?
You can tell it, yeah, sure.
With written on it in a Sharpie, Best Goddaughter Award.
Oh. Right. That's so lovely.
Gave it to my little one, who proceeded that night to sleep with it. Oh. Like, was like, you know, Uncle Chris. It's a lovely thing, and you know, it's because I always see it. I always get slightly annoyed if I see it written down and I see him referred to as my celebrity friend, because he's not my celebrity friend. He's my friend.
Yeah, because you've got Tom Cruise.
Tom Cruise is my celebrity friend.
Yeah, he's a and he's a proper celebrity. Let's be honest. He's proper.
Even I acknowledge it. Yeah. All right, let's not get into it now.
Hey, Michaela, you don't have any children, do you? Are you a godmother to anyone?
Yeah, I'm a really bad godmom.
Wow.
Yeah, it's really bad. Hi, Keisha. I'm so sorry. It's been a really long time.
Well, you just said hi. You said hi to her on TV. That's cool.
Yeah.
Hi, Keisha.
Yeah.
Like that.
How old is that?
Your uncle. That's your whole year done.
No. Keisha is my friend who had the child. I can't remember my goddaughter's name.
Holy shit! Did you meet Keisha just at the sex club just for a minute?
Here's something that will get you out of jail with Keisha's kid, whatever her name is. Because you're a huge fan, and you talk about yourself, of Beyoncé.
Yeah.
And Beyoncé collaborates and sings on Chris's new album.
Yeah.
Now, working with Bey...
You're pronouncing it almost perfectly.
Beyoncé.
Is it Beyoncé?
Beyoncé. It's spelled Beyoncé.
No, but you know it's Beyoncé.
I thought it was Beyoncé.
Bey, but you say Bey, like when you're like just bae. Saying like Bey.
I've seen people say she's my Bey. I thought that
she's
meant...
She's Bey.
I thought it's Beyoncé.
Queen Bey.
How old are you exactly?
I'm... Okay, so but when you're working with Beyoncé, that must be a fun day. Even for you, that must be quite some assurance, because her voice is extraordinary, is it not?
Oh, it's just... It was such a treat, and when we were making this album, I know her as a friend, and she's an absolutely lovely person. When she comes in the studio, you're suddenly reminded of, oh, that's why she is who she is, and it was just such a dream come true, and the whole album is about trying to make dreams come true. And a lot of the songs had this kind of angel figure who would keep popping up in the lyrics. And so I just asked her, is there any way you would come and basically sing the part of this angel that appears through the album? And she said, yeah. And it was just amazing. I can't put it any simpler than that.
There's a track on the album, Everglow. Is it called Everglow?
Everglow.
Everglow. And I love that phrase, and it's just a wonderful phrase. And there's a story behind where you got that from, I guess, is it?
Yeah, I got it from... You know how in movies surfers talk, like, hey, yeah, what a great day, man. Or something.
What movie was that?
You know the one.
Yeah, I know who you mean.
You know
was
the
that
one.
Prince so Charles that you just...
I just caught it.
I love to go surfing sometimes in my time off, and I was in the water next to this guy who used to be a Marine, a super tough guy, and he used to be a Calvin Klein model. Wow. So this is a very wonderful match of personalities in one person. He's like, God, yeah. I don't want to do the voice.
Try again.
Okay. Do it, good, good.
You know, I was out there...
This is awesome.
It's going great.
It's going great, man. Yeah. You know, I was with this guy. he was on his boy. He's like, you know, when it's something just gives you that everglow, you know?
And I was, everglow.
Yeah, and, it reminded me of two things. First of all, I was looking for a word to sum up the feeling you get when something is finished or someone's passed away, but you don't always have sadness about it. You have great memories or all the fond memories. And then also I was thinking about, you know, remember those old Ready Brick commercials?
Yeah, the kids would go out. Yeah.
And I was thinking a word that describes the warmth that the memory of someone can give you, or the memory of a relationship or a loved one. And he gave me that word.
Now, Gwyneth wrote part of Everglow, didn't she, or part of the song?
The story that... I mean, the internet is so wonderful, and God bless it. It does tend to change a seed into a forest.
Yeah.
And there was two lines of that song which she very kindly gave me the idea for. It was actually about her dad. We were talking about her dad who passed away. And, you know, that's how that came out.
And you know what is heartening, I think, for people is to see, you know, obviously you guys, you're not together anymore, not right. In the way you were, of course, but to see that level of closeness and that level of, you know, acceptance about where you are, but still being friends to that extent, that's a lovely thing.
Yeah, I'm very, very grateful, you know, and we have these two incredible children, and, yeah, it's been a strange and amazing path, but I'm so grateful to be right here, right now.
Well, you're in a happy place. Chris Martin, ladies and gentlemen, is going to perform live at Coldplay right now. Thank you, Chris. That was great. Over you go. You can go and get started. Get started. There we go. OK. Thank you. For all my guests tonight, of course, the fabulous Burt Reynolds, the brilliant Simon Pegg, and, of course, the wonderful Michaela Cole. They've all been great. Join me next week when I'll be joined by comedian John Bishop, Mel Giedroyce from the new Sound of Music show, which is going to be Cara Toynton. She's also on. And we have three-time Formula One world champion Lewis Hamilton on the show. But now here performing Adventure of a Lifetime from their great new album, Head Full of Dreams. It is, of course, Coldplay.
And yeah, she'd say everything you want's a dream away. Under this pressure, under this weight, we are diamonds.